MK Meitenbagana.
Queda uno, queda uno.
Uno. One, two, three.
Can't control, 'cause I want more of you, God. set you as a seal upon my heart, as a seal upon my arm. For there is love that is as strong as death, jealousy demanding as the grave.
As you can see, they were connected to a lot of ministry. It takes a lot. When I first had everything compiled, it was a 29-minute video, and we began the editing process to try to get it down into a more conducive time. There were some powerful moments in ministry, and I know they shared some things, but not all things, and only eternity will tell the story of what took place. So be looking out next year. We're going to take upwards of 20 people on the trip. And I believe it'll be another significant time of ministry as we are connected together to the mission field. Matthew chapter 15 is where I want to go with you just very quickly today. I do want to share the Word of God with you today because I believe that many times we face familiar trials. How many of you have ever been through something you said, man, I've been through this before? Financial, physical, emotional, relational, whatever the case may be. And you get into it and you're like, man, this is not the first time I've been around this mountain. And maybe before God moved in a very significant way, and maybe this time, maybe you're just kind of wondering, is God really going to come through? Is God really going to see me through what I'm facing? The answer is, of course, yes, but sometimes it's hard for us to see that. Matthew chapter 15, beginning in verse 32. Now Jesus called his disciples unto himself and said, I have compassion upon the multitude because they have now continued with me for 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I do not want to send them away hungry, lest they faint on the way. Then his disciples said to him, where could we get enough bread in this wilderness to fill such a great multitude? In other words, Jesus, we appreciate your sentiment here, but there's no way that we're going to be able to find enough bread to meet the need. And Jesus said to them, how many loaves do you have? Now, it's very interesting because this is not the first time they've been here. This is not the first time that they've had a great need, and the Lord asked them, how many loaves do they have? The first time, it was facing 5,000 people plus women and children. They estimate maybe around 20,000 just less than a month before in chapter 14. And Jesus, in that place, the disciples said, Lord, there's too many. Send them away. Have you ever had a need that you were just like, I wish you would just go away? I'm tired of dealing. I want it to go away. I don't want to deal with it anymore. I'm sick and I'm tired, and I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. And the Bible says, and they said, we have 7 loaves and a few little fish. So he commanded the multitude to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and the fish and gave thanks and broke them and gave them to his disciples. And the disciples gave them to the multitude. And so they all ate and were filled, and they took up 7 large baskets. It's very significant, of fragments that were left. Now those that ate were 4,000 men besides women and children. Verse 39, and he sent away the multitude, got into the boat, and came to the region of Magdala. Father, would you add your blessing to your word today? Let it be life to us, and we'll give you the honor and the praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. This is something I actually saw while we were in Colombia, and actually shared something similar with the church there in Fusa. But a lot of times we find ourselves going through a familiar situation. Maybe it's a physical situation. Maybe it's financial. Maybe it's an emotional thing where it just kind of seems like that we're facing the same thing. And when you face the same thing all over again, it's almost as if the first time never happened. And when I say the first time never happened, I'm talking about the miracle of the fact that you have made it through. The first time, it's very important to understand, the first time in chapter 14 when they faced the 5,000, we know that they had 5 loaves and 2 fish. And Jesus asked the disciples there, how many loaves do you have? Because the disciples were like, you know what, this is way too many people. The need is too great. Send them away and let them go fend for themselves. And Jesus says, no, I'm not going to send them away. I'm not going to get rid of the trial. But what I am going to do is do a miracle through your life. They had 5 loaves. The number 5 is very significant in Scripture, because every time you see the number 5, you see the grace of God. There were 5 cubits that the temple and the tabernacle were created a certain way. The number 5 is very significant. It represents grace. And the Lord showed the disciples, if you have grace, the grace of God, you can get through any trial that comes your way. The Bible tells us that His mercy and His grace is new every morning. But sometimes we can't stand going through the trouble. I've asked many times, why do I have to go through the things that I've gone through? Why? The why is not the important. It's the who that is the most important question. And the who is the Lord will sustain me all of my days, because He promised that He would never leave me or forsake me. And He does that through His Holy Spirit. We saw on Wednesday night, we began a new study on the God that I never knew. We also saw it dramatized last Sunday, that the Holy Spirit wants to empower us and walk with us. But sometimes in the darkness of life, we get discouraged. Anybody ever been there? I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm going to say. I don't know how I'm going to encourage other people, let alone myself, because I'm in a struggle and I'm in a storm and I just really don't understand. And I really wish that God would let me know the why and the how. I said many years ago, our children are a blessing from God. I love both of them very much. I'll put those things in there for Mason. Where's he at? Is he in here? There you are. I put those things because I always pick on him because he walks around like this. He goes, "Hello, I'm Mason McCarty. And I am a muscle-bound young man, and I will pump you up." You know, I always mess with him with that. So when he saw that, I wanted it to jog his mind. But I love him very dearly. And I went to Elizabeth's school this week. She got an award for being one of the top five female youth bowlers. And they came to the school and gave her an award. And I told her in front of the class, I said, "That's Daddy's baby. Daddy loves his baby girl." And so they were joking with her all day long about, "Daddy, baby girl, you know, all that kind of stuff. But you know what? Years ago, young in ministry, young in marriage, we're having children. And I'll never forget when we were at the hospital to find out about Elizabeth. Yes. We never found out like regular folk. She had a urinary tract infection. "Oh my gosh, you're telling your business, please." Some of you tell worse than that on Facebook. So don't look at me like that. Don't look at me like that. "I can't believe he said urinary tract infection in the pulpit." You've probably had them. Part of life. But anyway, we never found out like regular people. They come in there and they grab her hand and rub her hand. I'm thinking, "Oh my good Lord, she's dying." And they said, "Honey, you're pregnant." I went, "Oh, how in the world did that happen? What are you talking about? She's pregnant." Again, and I jumped up and stormed out the room, and one of the nurses that had seen me at Riverside Hospital last, she comes out there, she goes, "Oh, Reverend." "Don't you reverend me right now? I'm mad. Don't you throw a preacher card at me." And she goes, "Oh, Reverend, Jesus knows the future. He holds the video of your future." I looked at her, whew. I said, "Don't you think I know that?" I said, "I just wish he'd let me rent it every once in a while to let me know that everything's going to be all right." Now, you've been there. Well, you'd really like to know, how are you going to get through this mess? And how are you going to get through the storm? Now, my baby's over there. You are not a mess. I'm just using that to relate a story to the people today. Daddy loves him babies, okay? You just understand that. But here's the thing. Here's the disciples. They've already been through one struggle. How many of you have been through at least one struggle in your life? Okay. They've already been through one significant struggle where they've got to feed upwards of 20,000 people. Now, that's a big buffet. And they're like, "You know what? This is too big. Send them away. We don't want anything to do with this." And sometimes in our mind, we think if God can just get rid of the storm, we'd be better off if we didn't have to go through where we are. But here's the interesting thing. You're going through it. You're not staying there. But you cannot forget the faithfulness of God a month ago, or a year ago, or 2 weeks ago, or 5 weeks ago. You can't forget the faithfulness of God. And that's what the disciples did. In chapter 15, the Bible says, the disciples look at him and say, "We don't have what it takes to meet this need. There's not enough bread. We don't have what it takes. It's just an impossible situation." But that's not the first time they'd been there. And Jesus says to them, familiar words, "How many loaves do you have?" Look at your neighbor and say, "You've got what it takes." You see, the first time in this situation, they had five loaves and two fish. Five significant of grace, two representative of Jesus Christ. And when you go through a storm, if you have the grace of God and His presence with you, you can get through anything. But in this one, and it's interesting that at the end of the first miracle, they had 12 baskets of fragments left over. The number 12, there was 12 disciples, 12 tribes of Israel. The number 12 is very significant because it talks about God establishing something in the earth. Look at me for a moment. The very first time you went through the struggle that's similar to like some of you are going through today, the very first time you went through it, it was God establishing something in your life as a result of His grace. We get mad in storms and we say, oh, I've got to have a positive confession of faith. And we got to name it, claim it, blab it, grab it, and all this other kind of stuff. And maybe something will happen. And we go, this isn't happening and I'm not here. This isn't happening and I'm not here. This isn't happening and I'm not here. And then we open our eyes and we say, oh, Lord, it is happening and I'm here. I don't want to be here. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. But what do you do when the storm repeats? Do you, like the disciples, you say, we don't have what it takes. This is bigger than we are. I'm struggling. I want out of this boat. I want out of this circumstance. I don't want to go through it anymore. I'm tired of it. Listen, we don't have the luxury of throwing in the towel. Jesus already threw the towel in when He gave His life so that we wouldn't have to throw in the towel. He gave Himself so that we could make it through every storm. But here's the significant point of this. At this portion of Scripture, the Bible says that they don't have five loaves. How many do they have? Say this with me. I am a work in progress. Now look at your neighbor and help them. Say, you know you're a work in progress. And smile at them. Some of them needed to hear that. They really did. They needed to hear that today. You're a work in progress. Listen, He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. I'm on the potter's wheel, but not all the time is the potter's wheel fun. Not all the time is a difficulty fun. Not all the time is a family issue fun. Is a financial issue fun? Is a physical issue fun? It's not all fun. You know what? I don't walk around all day long going, ha, 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 and just clowning around. There's some days, like yesterday when I walked around the backyard and I seen a tree, I said, oh. That's not good. So my first thing was, oh, this really stinks. Then a couple of the guys came over and we were laughing and cutting up as Mason decides he's going to pick up a whole tree by himself. He did. I'll take care of it, Dad. No, you know, that kind of thing. And he did. He put the towel on his shoulder and gets up underneath it to try to prop it up. I'm shaking my head. But we were able to laugh and we were able to have fellowship in the midst. Look, I really don't like having a hole in the side of my house. It's just not cool. Not to mention they probably don't even make that kind of siding anymore. And, you know, just it's not cool. But you know what? We all go through struggles. We all go through storms. I faced surgery on the 9th. I don't like it. But I know God will be glorified through in the midst of it. Not just do a work in me, but I believe do a work in all of us together. He said, I don't understand that. I don't know either. I just know that's something the Lord spoke to me, that He's going to be working in all of us at that time. I don't know what that's going to look like. I have no clue, okay? But here's something I've come to understand. I freak out when I face the next storm that looks like what I went through yesterday. I can miss my appointed moment for God to do a completive work in my life. See, the first time you face a storm, it's God's grace showing you can get through. But when you face it again, it's not necessarily that you are a bad person or something. It's God trying to do a completed work in your life. The number 7 is significant because it denotes a completion on the earth. The first time you went through it, it was the grace of God being applied to your life so that you could get through. But now if you find yourself in a similar storm, yes, God's grace is there. Yes, God's presence is there. Yes, His mercy is there. But He's trying to do a work in you that you could not do yourself. Don't despise your trouble. Don't despise your storm. Look, that gust of wind blew down a tree in my backyard. You know what the good side is? That's one less that I've got to cut down. I'm just sorry the house propped it up. If it had just gusted the other way, it would have been fine with me. Then it had gone down the hill. But don't despise your day of struggle. But I don't like it. I know you don't like it, but there are things about God that you are learning in the middle of your struggle that's doing a completed work in your life. You can't unplug now. You can't give up. Because he hadn't brought you this far to drop you on your head, and he's not brought you this far to let grace slip out of your life. God has always been faithful. I've had so many people, listen, I appreciate the ministry of encouragement. I don't appreciate the ministry of encouragement through discouragement. I'll let that marinate. Some of you are like, well, I don't understand. You ever had somebody try to encourage you through discouragement? Well, I just don't think you ought to do that because there's just problems attached to it. I don't think you ought to go to, listen, I had people tell me, Pastor, I just don't think you should go to Columbia. And those words rang in my ear when we hit turbulence. I never knew a plane could fishtail. It's the only time I yelled at our team. That plane fishtailed, and it was like hitting potholes in the sky. Bam, 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 bam. And then we just dropped, and everybody goes, whoo! And Mason goes, we're all going to die. And I turned around. He did. We're all going to die. I turned around and said, shut up. Shut your mouth right now. You're freaking everybody on the plane out. Me. Don't say we're all going to die. And so my mind starts going, I told you not to go to Columbia. It's amazing how we can be gifted through discouragement. It's not a gift. Sometimes you've got to hold on to the record of God's faithfulness of yesterday to get through today. See, there's been a lot of records of God's faithfulness yesterday that gets me through today. These disciples forgot just for a moment his faithfulness. And I don't know where you are. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're struggling with. But you cannot forget the faithfulness of God from a chapter ago. It's interesting that it's a chapter back to back. There are times in our lives that we go through one chapter to another. You cannot forget God's faithfulness in a chapter that you've already been through. You're in a new place, but the storms still look alike. How many of you know a financial problem is just simply a financial problem? A physical problem is a physical problem. An emotional problem is an emotional problem, but God is bigger. Our God is greater than any of it, and his grace is sufficient. But you've got to understand that in the middle of it all, God is trying to do something in your life that is significant. You can't give up now. You can't throw in the towel. You can't quit. You can't run the opposite direction. What you have to do is embrace the grace that you walked in a chapter ago and understand that he'll be faithful today. I don't know when. I don't know how. I don't know where. I don't know why, but I do know who. And he said he would never leave me nor forsake me. And while there are moments that I struggle and I cry and I say, God, I don't want to go through this. And I face my own private garden of Gethsemane where I'm crying and I'm saying, God, I don't want to go through this, but nevertheless, not my will be done, but your will be accomplished. He's working a completed work in my life and he's working a completed work in yours. Don't jump ship now. But I'm tired. I know you're tired. Don't quit. My strength is, I know your strength gives out on you, but you can't quit. Sometimes you just need the hand of another person looking you in the face saying, it's going to be all right. Sometimes you need just a moment of peace and clarity whereby you know that everything's going to work out for your good. The scripture is still true. All things work together for them that love God and are the called according to his purpose. I don't know how, but God just somehow makes it all right. What have you walked in here today? Maybe you came in here today with some familiar storm, something similar to you walked into before. And the Lord's question to the disciples mirrored the same a chapter ago, and it was, how much do you have? Well, wait a minute. Why would God ask, how much do I have? Because there is no true miracle unless God partners with your faith. There is no such miracle. Without faith, it is impossible to please God, correct? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it we obtain a favorable testimony or report. Hebrews 11, the hall of faith. So there takes feet from you in partnership with God. And the Lord says, how many loaves do you have? You would have thought that this would have rung a bell with Peter, but it didn't. They said, all we've got is seven and a few little fish. Can I tell you something? The first time they went through it, they had five and two. But this time they go through it, they have seven and a few. They had more. Listen to me. When you let grace do a work in your life, that the next time God does a completed work because you have grown in your faith, you are not in the same place that you were a chapter ago. This is a new place in your life, a new season in your life, and you are stronger than you were the first time. Stop telling yourself you're weak. Stop telling listen, stop doing it like Hitler said, saying a lie loud enough and long enough to yourself to where eventually you believe this very lie you're screaming to yourself. Don't do that. His strength is perfect when my strength is gone. He'll carry me when I can't carry myself. He's always been mindful of where I am. The first time he gave you grace, you come to the keyboard. The first time he gave you grace to get through. But this time you didn't lose grace, did you? There was an increase from five to seven, which signified God is now working with grace to complete a work on the inside of you. Here's what I know. You ever heard this statement? And sometimes when you're in the middle of the storm, you want to slap the person that says it. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Well, you go through it and see how you feel. You know, that kind of thing. But I want to tell you, in the kingdom of God, what you don't let destroy you. Notice I said not what God. What you don't let destroy you. God will take and do a completed work on the inside of you so that when you come out of it the next chapter, you're stronger, you're more equipped, and your testimony is that much more solidified because you've walked it. And let me just tell you this. Look right up here. Your miracle is never a fluke. See, if something just happened one time, we could excuse and say, well, it just happened. That's the way society is. Well, it just happened. No, but when you have a repeated miracle in your life, the same thing, that's not just a happenstance. That is the grace of God at work in your life to complete something in you. He's that faithful that he loves you enough to do a completed work in your life. How many loaves do you have? Pastor, all I have. You ready for this? This is what blows me away in this scripture. They had seven. Watch this. It's no different than the first time. The equation's a little bit different. What'd they have the first time? Five loaves and two fish. But this time, grace multiplied in their life. They had seven loaves. They had grace and Jesus formed in their life, and they were able to get through the next struggle. They were able to get through the next storm. And that's where some of you are today. But boy, does it get hard when you're in a storm. Would you stand? How many loaves do you have? Well, all I have is seven, but look closer at what you have. You have grace and Jesus that form the perfect combination for you to get through this storm again. Just want to ask you one question. You're here today. And I know you're here today because the Lord wouldn't have put this on my heart, because I wasn't planning on preaching this. Because usually I like to have some kind of notes with me, and it takes away your safety net. And this is not something to be ashamed of, because we all go through struggles. But if you're here today and you say, Pastor, I'm going through something I'm facing, and it's not the first time I faced it. It's like going around the mountain again, and I find myself in the same type of storm today, but I'm not going to give up, and I need an extra touch of God's grace to get through until the miracle manifests in my life. and I have seven loaves. I've got His grace, and I've got Him that are forming in my life for a miracle. But you're here and you say, I'm going through a familiar storm, something that's very significant, that I've been in this place before, and I need God's help, just an extra touch of His grace to get through. Here's what I want you to do. I just want you to step out of your seat and come stand in this altar. I want us to pray with you. Come on, I know you're here. I'm not going to tell you to bow your eyes and close your head. And if you've ever heard me say that, don't shut it down just yet. I said that right. But you're going through something that's similar than what you went through before. I want us to agree with you in prayer. Just step out of your seat and come stand up here. Because here's one thing I know, that God is able. He's able to give you strength. He's able to sustain you. He's able to let you know that everything's going to be all right. It's not going to crumble. It's not going to fail. You're not going to lose. You're not going to lose a loved one. You're not going to lose significant ground because God is faithful. Here's what I know. What I put in His hand, He is faithful to sustain. Anybody else before we pray? I've asked those that have been in our prayer training to get ready because I want to surround every person up here for prayer. But anybody else, we're going to agree together and ask God to touch and meet whatever need that's present in the lives of His people. Okay? If our prayer team would come as they sing, I just want you to just stand in this altar and let us agree with you in prayer and ask God to do a work in your life that you need Him to do. Amen.
When He calls my name, oh, my soul.